Love you this morning. You're a great God. If you weren't here earlier, just so you know, every seat in this sanctuary was prayed over. You were prayed over before you walked in that door. It's because we trust our Lord. For many of us, He saved us. We're saved. We've trusted in Him and believed in Him. And this morning could be your day. This morning could be your time of recognizing you can't do it on your own. You've got to have Him. And He wants to just wrap you up and save you, walk with you every day, have a relationship with you, and love on you. If you've never trusted Him, let today be the day. Let's sing "How Great Is Our God."
Our God, sing with me how great. Thank you. Can you give the Lord a great big hand for just being a good God this morning? Hallelujah. 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 Listen. If you're glad to be here, you need to let somebody close to you know that. Just say, I'm glad I made it and I'm glad to see you today. Take a minute and tell them. Let you know how we feel about people coming to visit with us today and be our guests. So church, let everybody know inside and outside, we're glad that they are with us today. There's a song that says the presence of the Lord is here and I can feel it in the atmosphere. And let me tell you something, God is here, God has been working, and He's moving in mighty, mighty ways. And we're going to receive our offering in a few minutes, in just a minute. But I want to... Well, y'all going to have to do it again. You're going to have to do it again. And it's my fault for not telling you. So that's just the Lord's way of telling y'all you didn't do what you're supposed to do the first go around. So He's giving you a mulligan right now. All right? This is going to be a hole in one this time. But we always, speaking of visitors, guests, we have a card. You've probably seen the slide up there a couple of times. And now's a good opportunity to just jot that information down. And if you didn't get it in on the first offering at Multitudes, you can get it in on the second offering at Multitudes. But every year, we always make sure that we are a part of Fellowship of Christian Athletes. And this week, and I need to stop making an announcement right quick. And I'm through making announcements during church, but this is a good announcement that just happened. We're going through, you know, Walmart and Lowe's and all these people are doing what they call a reset. And so Multitudes is going through our own reset. And, you know, we know about the parking lot. It's going to be warm very soon, and they'll knock that out. But everything from the bulletin you hold to the inside. In fact, the nursery, if I can get all of the dilapidated men that I've talked to this morning, including myself, the nursery will be double the size this time next week because we bless with babies, man, and children. And so we're going to make sure, and we were going to do that before today, but I want to give everybody hope because it looked like Black Friday in that room a while ago. And so we have it on paper in our heads, but next week, I'm just getting everybody hope. If you can bear with us next week, we'll have like an infant or a newborn or a younger section, then we'll have an older section, and you'll actually go in through the foyer. So all this is taking place, foyer. We're going through a lot of good changes as far as the facilities and all that. Well, why are you doing that? Well, the world's doing it. If the world does it for their house, the Bible says morning by morning, new mercies I see. So if God's willing to do something fresh and new for me every day, then I don't need to get used to His house. Everybody in here, you change a chair out, carpet out, you paint, you do something at your house. So we're doing that because the Lord's doing great new things, and we need to show Him we are happy to be a part of that. And so bear with us, and it's only getting better. So Fellowship of Christian Athletes, we do it every year. For those of you who don't know, Paul Lemon, he's gonna just tell you about it, but it's a great program. There's no riffraff. none of these things where you see sending money to an organization or a group and they're getting like 80% for administrative fees and all this other stuff, or marketing, and 20% or less goes, this is 100% goes 100%. And it puts Bibles in the hands of athletes and students. So at this time, I want you to let the Lord know that we're glad to be a part of this and give God a great big hand as Paul Lemon comes and talks to you.
Wow. What an awesome, awesome spirit of the Lord in this place today. 1 year ago to today, I was just moved out of intensive care into a regular room. And the doctor says 2 out of 3 die from the infection I had in my body. See, I'm going to talk about Bibles. I just want to talk to you about how great our God is. Because a doctor said 2 out of 3 die. Mike and Sheila, thank you for 40 plus years of love. Y'all are so special to me. And if I've done anything to ever hurt you, I apologize right here. You are so special to me. Mike Webb went to the hospital while I was in there. He went to see somebody else. But he saw me and he prayed for me. The doctor said 2 out of 3 die of what you had. And I was in the operating room on that third surgery. And I said, Lord, if you're through with me, go ahead and take me. Let's get it over with. And he said, just like I'm talking to you, Paul, I got you back. Paul, I got you back. I didn't wake up in the recovery room like you usually do. It was a Saturday morning. I woke up in a regular room. And due to the type of infection I had to stay in the hospital about 30 days. But ever since then, I've seen person after person after person after person healed. I went to a hospital room and they had the people there that took your organs. They were there. No hope, no chance. That young man got saved. That young man's serving the Lord now. If he'd have died that day when they were there to take his organs. Young man gets hit with a tree. There's no hope. He's preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ now. So I don't know what you're going through today. There's no doubt in my mind there's a healing in this house today. And there's no doubt in my mind I was supposed to be here today. Opie will tell you, we talked about different dates, but he scheduled me for today because that's what God wanted me to do. We started our little ministry because a young man said he didn't have a Bible. I know that's hard for multitudes to believe. It was hard for me to believe that somebody in Scotland County didn't have a Bible. 12 people gave $100. We were able to buy 200 Bibles at $6 a piece. They were $17.95 when we started negotiating. They put them on sale. God made a reinvestment. So we were able to give out 200 Bibles. We gave the football team Bibles, and the cheerleaders got mad because they didn't get Bibles, so we gave the cheerleader Bibles. And I want you to listen. I'm getting ready to tell you that 200 Bibles has turned over to 13,000 Bibles. And over 8,000 commitments to Jesus Christ. See, that's right. When we go into a school, where I go in there, I get a little excited, and I just say, Jesus loves me. Yes, I know, for the Bible tells me so. And then I tell them it's not in there, because it's not. Those exact words are not in there. Something very close. John 3:16 says, For God gave his what? Only begotten Son. And if that ain't Jesus loves me, yes, I know, for the Bible tells me, so I really don't know what it is. We give out mainly 3 Bibles. Our athlete's Bible, which is a very nice Bible. It's a paperback Bible. And we go to schools and give it out. This year alone, over 1,200 Bibles were given out. And I did something different this year just to see. I would say, if you have never received your own Bible, your very own Bible, make sure you let me know. We had over 75 people tell us this was their only first Bible. That's amazing to me that people in Scotland and Robinson and Richmond and Moore and Marlborough don't have Bibles. That is just so amazing to me. And then we do a competitor's Bible that we give to the seniors. We do this at Richmond in Scotland. If they're a senior, they get their own Bible with their own name on it, with their number, their jersey. And that ministry I never thought meant so much to people, but I had so many of those young people come up to me and say, I got a leather Bible with my name on it, and it's mine forever. And then we do a ministry that a lot of people don't understand, and we didn't really understand it when we started, called Bibles for Whistles. It's for our referees. I know none of you have ever hollered at a referee. Nobody's ever hollered at an umpire. Nobody's never said kill the umpire. But I want to just give you some information that you probably don't know. And this is going to probably shock you. Jesus loves referees. And he loves umpires. Because every call they make, they're 50% wrong if it's a close call. At least 50. Because umpires sometimes can make you repent and you didn't even know it. So what we do, we set up their dressing rooms. We did this in all 8 schools that's in our conference this year. We put Bibles in the referee room along with some food. We give them soap, shampoo, towels, washcloths, and we look after the referees. This year alone, just this year alone, we had 3 referees get saved. And let me tell you something that... Let me just tell you something that amazes me. A 72-year-old man got saved in our ministry after a game in that little walkway near the field house. 72 years old. Because of you, because of multitudes, and y'all been a partners there from the start. Y'all feed our football team. Anytime I call, y'all do stuff for us. But because of you, you're making a difference, one Bible at a time in someone's life. I'm asking you, would you invest in our ministry? Would you make a difference in someone's life? If you go write a check, just write it to the church, and they'll write me one check at the end. Thank you so much, multitudes, for what you do for the kingdom, what you do for Fellowship of Christian Athletes. And thank you again for each and every one of you. I love you for praying for me all year round. God bless you.
Amen. I tell you, you won't regret putting the word in somebody's hand, especially a youth, a referee, anybody. And I just thank God we can do this. I really do. I know we've already received the offering, but we're going to receive another offering, and we're going to give you a treat. A lot of you were so blessed, and we all were, by the youth last week, that we've asked them to do an encore performance of what I believe is taking place, a revival in the land. If you have ran out of money, physical money, and you don't even have a check like Paul talked about, I've got some wonderful, wonderful news. You can go right this minute to the Multitudes Church app. If you don't go online to the website, go to the app, and you can give whatever the Lord lays on your heart while you're sitting there. You can. There's always instructions on the screen, but just go there and give, and in the memo part, put FCA. That's all you have to do, and we'll know what to do, and get that there. And on your way out today, you're going to get a couple of treats. On your way out today, you're going to get a pack of Easter cards. There's only going to be 5 in the set. And what we need for you to do is to pray over them first. That you won't just like get rid of them like throwing candy at a Christmas parade, but God will lead you. And we only want you to give out 1 per week over the next 4 weeks, all right? Well, you give out 1 5 weeks total, but just save 1 per week and ask God every week, Lord, help me to give this in the right hands, just like we talked about the Bible's falling in the right hands, and God will lead you to that. So let's pray over the giving, that God would use our church. And this is part of putting Ching Ching in heaven. This is how you do it. This is where fruit is when you help the Lord out. And that's what we're doing through the vessel of FCA. So we're going to pray that God would anoint what we can't do. And then you're going to get your first fruit, all right? So let's pray together. Father, we love you. And we thank you so much that we can be a part of your kingdom and your work, Lord. And I just pray right now, Lord, that you would bless those that are faithful to the word of God and the distribution of that. We pray over every athlete, every student, every coach, referee that will get a Bible, that in the name of Jesus, their lives would be transformed by the renewing of their mind and the Spirit of God would live in them forever. And God, and I pray that you would anoint our giving today, because we are limited, but we serve a limitless God. And Lord, I want you to be glorified. And thank you for just letting us do this. And all you do, we'll give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the center of the caverns of hell, hidden under layers of evil that have thrived for centuries, sets the morbid domain of the prince of the power of the air. Suddenly, a scaly creature disrupts Satan's ghastly existence with an urgent message, and it reads, no dread problem, confidence needed, disaster forecasted. With a disgust and annoyance, this general of evil agrees to confer with his chief demon lieutenant. This is the story of that encounter.
You may enter.
My lord Satan.
State your business and make it fast.
Sir, we're having problems of cataclysmic proportions.
Where?
In the east sector, sir. The damage is vast.
Is there something wrong with my abortion clinics?
Well, no, sir. That's all fine. We kill 4,000 unborn a day through, shall we say, surgical removal.
Good.
It's selective breeding. We eliminate human life in the name of convenience, like the Nazis and the Jews and with the government's approval.
Is there a problem with my pet project, television violence?
Sir, it's covered from videos to cartoons. By the time a child graduates high school, he's seen 70,000 murders.
Is this effective enough?
Sir, just watch the news.
Is there a disturbance in my false religion?
Oh, no, sir. Business is booming. Over 40 million are into New Age and Zen. Over 45 million believe in astrology.
Looks like we are catching up.
Yes, sir. Only 50 million claim to be born again.
Is there a problem with business in general?
Sir, we're showing tremendous progress.
Yes.
Teenage runaways, each year a million or more. There's a teen suicide every 90 minutes. And your specialty, drunk driving,
yes,
will claim more lives this year than the whole Vietnam War.
Well, is there a disturbance in... What was that?
Sir, that's the reason all these demons are on crutches and wobbling.
What's going on?
Sir, that's what I've been trying to tell you.
What is that?
Sir, that is our problem.
Only one thing causes warfare of this magnitude.
Then, sir, you know what we are dealing with up there.
Yes, it's some of those sanctified...
Tri-blood-bought...
Spirit-filled...
Saints of God...
Actually...
Presently on their knees...
In prayer.
Sir, they're literal holy terrors. They bind us, cast us out. Then they do those disgusting charismatic jigs. They quote scriptures like the Son of God. And, sir, if you don't intervene, we all might wind up in a bunch of pigs. Sir, that's the good news. The bad news is the subject of their prayers that threatens our survival. What they're praying for is causing hemorrhaging in the realms of darkness.
And the bad news is...
Sir... They're praying for revival!
I hate revival. It just erupts. It's hardly controllable. At the Azusa Street outpouring, things got rough.
Yes, sir. And when the charismatic movement hit, sir, we were jumping out of windows. With all of that, untie my bow tie. Who stole my hand this stuff?
Then I'll come in like a flood.
But they'll say the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against you. It's written in the Word.
I'll form weapons against
them. Sir, no weapon formed against them shall prosper. That's in the Bible, too.
Yes, I've heard. I'll hit them with every filthy, lusty thought you can imagine.
But it's written, resist the devil, he must flee.
Obviously, the enemy is taking the battle more seriously than we are.
And that's very dangerous, sir. Especially for me.
It's time to launch my final wolfish attack. I'll remind the saints of their past. How they were liars, cheaters, manipulators, and moochers.
But sir, you know what will happen if you remind the saints of their past.
And what is that?
Sir, they'll just remind you of your future. Attention all saints of God, man your battle stations.
I guess somebody just unplugged it. But you know what? There is going to be a revival in this place and in this land. Now we need to pray because we're about to look inside of this book right here. And when you do that, a couple of different things happen. Number one, you start thinking about things that you haven't thought about all weekend long or all morning right now. And then if that's not enough, something happens that will just get your attention or my attention. And so what we do, we just say, God, we need your help because this is not a TV guide. A lot of you under 30 or 40 don't know what a TV guide is, but anyway. I could really say Reader's Digest. It really confused the church. But anyway, it's not a Reader's Digest or a TV guide, so there's a lot of opposition to the distribution of this book and the preaching and receiving. So let's pray right now. Lord, we love you and we thank you for this book called Your Word. And God, and I know that in the name of Jesus, that this book right here is the only book and the only thing that will last. So God, I pray that you would anoint me to say what you want said today, and you would anoint us all to hear what you want us to hear. And God, everything that you do, we're going to give you praise for it because you're worthy, and help us not to be distracted nor distract. And all you do, God, I'm going to give you praise for it too. Amen. Now listen closely and read along with me. We're going to go through about five or six scriptures, and I need you to pay attention because there's something inside of these five and six scriptures that are going to kind of have a common denominator. So we're going to start. If you are in your phone, people say if you're in your Bible, but if you're in your phone, if you go to the sermon notes today, you can follow along, and everything's already there for you. But if you have your Bibles, you can go with us to Proverbs chapter 12, verse 13. The wicked is ensnared by the transgression of his lips, but the righteous will come through trouble. And then over in the 15th chapter, the 29th verse, it reads, "The Lord is far from the wicked, but he heareth the prayer of the righteous." In the 18th chapter, he says, "The name of the Lord is a strong tower." Say that with me, a strong tower. The righteous run to it and are safe. And then Psalm 37, I want to read this whole chapter to you, but I'm not. And I want you to go home and read it because the whole book pretty much is about the righteous. So we're going to look at verse 23. "The steps of a good man are ordered." How many of you ever had an order taken? Or maybe this week, "I want ham, I want cheese, I want pepperoni." So you know what it means to give an order, and you know what it means to take an order. Well, this scripture tells us that the steps that we walk with our feet, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. I believe Paul's here today because God took the order and gave it to an angel and said, "I want Paul Lemon at Multitudes Church this day to take up money for my word to go to students." And I believe that just like I said it. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he, talking about the Lord, delighteth in his way. And over in the New Testament, in First Peter chapter 3, the Bible says, "For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers." There's a distinction there, who he's listening to. "But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil." Imagine that. The ears of the Lord are open to the righteous, but the face of the Lord is set against those that practice and live and do evil. And then a lot of you know this by heart, but James said in the 5th chapter, "To confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed." Here we go. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Now, God, I need again for you to do this because I'm just made out of that stuff called flesh, but the Spirit of God can rise up in me and through me, and we all can be edified in Jesus' name. Amen. So, the word righteous, you heard it a number of times, and the word righteous is just pretty much being just or right and doing the right thing the way God would do it. So when you hear the word righteous or a righteous man or a righteous woman or are living a righteous life. That just means you're a person that regardless of what the outcome is or the ramifications, that you do things right. You do it the right way, whether it costs you or it rewards you. You do the right thing. And when you do that, church, and it's not automatic in the way of just saying, well, I'm a Christian. It doesn't mean that, because there's a lot of unrighteous people that call themselves Christians. And the Lord doesn't hear their cry. He does not respond to what they call their prayer. Their steps are ordered by themselves or other people or the devil. And they're not ordered by God, and they're always bumping into stuff. So when you do the right thing, regardless of the outcome, and you live the right way, make right decisions, that's what it means to be righteous. Now, why is it important to talk about this? Well, you know, we're still in the kingdom of God. And one of the things that the kingdom of God taught us, that it was not flesh and blood, but the kingdom of God, where all the good stuff is, where you were really like these people that were in revival of the land and you're taken apart. The kingdom of God is this right here. It's righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. That's what it is. So when I'm doing right, living right, doing the right things the way God would do them regardless, and I'll just give you a quick illustration about that. What does that mean? Well, I was talking to a friend of mine one time, and it was around tax season, and they were telling me about the fact that someone they knew, and this is kind of a testimony to the accountant this person was using, but it said that they knew that that person had said they had to they got to change accountants because their accountant was too honest. Do I need to play the Jeopardy music, or do y'all get that? We got that one. See, when you make your mind up, you're going to live righteous. You're going to live righteous in everything, including your pocketbook and billfold. See, a lot of people give themselves unrighteous permission at tax time. Jesus said, you need to give Caesar what belongs to him, and you need to give me what belongs to me. See, we are convicted about giving God. Some of us are. Some of us are going to stand before God and have to try to explain to him why we gave our permission to keep his 10%. And you will stand before him with your jaws vibrating, trying to tell him something he really don't even want to hear. I wasn't even going there today, but the Holy Ghost did, so it is what it is. When you live righteous, and it's not option, in fact, it's second nature because it's your primary nature, so it doesn't matter. You just make your mind up, I'm going to do the right thing all the time. Doesn't matter who's with me, who's not looking. And I remember when we had the daycare, we always had, and Frankie would say this, and this was kind of our, it's kind of our motto over there. People say, you know, different places would say, well, we got to get ready. The state lady's coming. And, you know, she would say, we would all say, she can come anytime she wants to, because we do it the same way all the time. See, when you do things the right way, it's like telling the truth. You don't have to remember what I need to do right now because of this. Am I preaching to anybody at all today? Just take in the word with me today. I'm taking it in. So when you do the right thing, it always seems like the wrong thing is getting rewarded and the wrong thing is actually getting ahead, but it's not, because you're looking at it through carnal eyes and the world's eyes. And see, when you decide, well, I'm going to be a kingdom person, then you're going to do things that people, maybe even in your own house or your own family or your immediate circle, are going to question, I wouldn't do that if that was me. Another quick story, real quick. I'll never forget the time, and just bear with me. You've heard this at least two times, I know. And I'm not bragging on anybody but the Spirit of God. I remember that around Christmas time, I had received an iPad that was straight from Apple. I had an iPad, and it was twice the memory mine was. It was Retina display. I had redneck display, which is the cheaper version. I can't tell the difference. But anyway, I'd gotten that in, and I did everything in my power. I'm giving you cliff notes. I called and communicated with Apple five different times, just trying to get this iPad that was not mine back to Apple so they could get it to the right person. The next to the last time I finally talked to someone, says, well, yeah, we see where it's this, but it's a different address. But some of the address corresponded with our address, but it was like in New Jersey or something like that, and it ended up there. And the whole time, everybody that knew about that, you know, I'd keep that thing. They got billions of dollars. I'd keep that thing. But it was not the right thing to do. It wasn't the right thing to do. And then they told me, yeah, well, the lady would just lose her money, you know, if she don't return it or whatever. We finally was able to get it back. Well, we ain't doing that. That might have been for a grandchild or a daughter or something like that. So fast forward, that was in like November, December, and I almost kept it because I could not even get any help to return it back to where it belongs. Not one time or two or three or four, but five attempts. And I finally was able to get an emailed return, RMA, a shipping label to send it back. And that was like my last time, though. So we went to the big show that we go down for LOL, called Infocom. It's a big technical show, rigging and all this stuff. Huge worldwide show. Well, there's about 30-something thousand people there. And you register for everything because you get, you know, it's like Halloween for adults. I mean, you're just filling your bags full of pencils and pens and Uzis and T-shirts. You're just doing it. It's a convention, man, and it's just good. And so, you know, you walking around like Santa Claus with bags of stuff you ain't never going to touch, but you do it because it's free. You know how we are from Scottco, amen? And Roco and Robco, so there you go. And Moco. So I think I covered everybody around us. So we get down there. I register with everything else we registered for. And about 2 weeks later, I get a random call from this lady. She said, is your name Opie Swells? I said, yes. She said, well, I just want to let you know that iPad we were giving away to one of the attendees, you won it. What? Y'all, 30-something thousand people. Winner chicken dinner. Now, I didn't win that. I've been praying. I've been wanting to get Angie an iPad. And so I got her one. But there is no doubt in my mind that God protected that one ballot with my name on it out of 30-something thousand people because I had already paid for that iPad with His righteousness. You see, the righteousness that we have inside of us is not our own anyway. If we were righteous, there would not be a need for a cruel old cross. There's nothing in us good. And when you do things right, the right way, you are gradually walking into the kingdom of God. And all of you know that's been here what's inside the kingdom of God. And so, what do I do? And the very first verse we read was the 12th chapter of Proverbs, where it says, the wicked is ensnared by the transgression of his lips. That means, you know, his mouth writes a check that his butt can't cash, is what my daddy used to say. Man, it means so much more than that. You talk smack, but you can't back it up. It gets you in trouble all the time. But the latter part of that verse just drives it home. It says, but the just shall come out of trouble. And everybody in here, you either are in or you are associated with somebody that's in some kind of trouble. And like the lady with the issue of blood, you can't buy your way out of it. You can't talk your way out of it. But I tell you what you can do. You can righteously come through it through the power of the Spirit of God if you choose today who you're going to serve. You can come through it. And so what do I do when I come through things? The Bible tells us in the 4th chapter of Acts, these guys, Peter and those that were just blazing the trail with him, they were in the middle of a situation that they needed to come through. And they had been threatened. Let me just read it to you. The Bible says they had been threatened and all the things they were threatened with about not preaching about Jesus anymore, that if they didn't quit it, it was going to cost them something. And see, when you preach the gospel or when you give toward the gospel, that's an act of righteousness. When you read your Bible, that's a righteous thing to do. And they were doing that. And when you spread the word of God, you give out your 5 Easter cards. You're doing a righteous thing. And when you do a righteous thing, the devil can't stand it. And that's what happened. They had done all this, so they brought them into the officials, you know, the church officials. The church is the biggest enemy of the cross of Jesus Christ. Amen. The church is the biggest enemy. It's not the world. It's not CNN and the White House and Hollywood. They're doing what sin does. The biggest enemy of the cross of Jesus Christ is the church of Jesus Christ. Because, you know, everything from segregation on Sunday, we don't have it, praise God. We're liberated from that. Everything from segregation to what I want, my feelings, take me into consideration, all of those things. But when you say, I'm just going to live righteous and I'm going to do the things that God would do the way God does them, the devil's going to try to shut you down. That's why the devil wants to shut this church down. Because we have no pursuit but the presence of God. And I want everybody to be clear on that. I'm not concerned about anything but pursuing God. If people come, people come. If people don't come because you pursue God, I'm still going to pursue God. Because God's my only hope. He's my only resource. And this is what happened to Peter and those guys. And they said, this is what we want you to know. Make sure that it does not spread no farther among the people. Let us straitly threaten them that they speak henceforth to no man in this name anymore. And when you decide that you're going to live a righteous life, you're going to meet all kinds of resistance and all that. And when this happens, you've got to spread it, church. You got to spread it. You may not have gotten the paycheck you wanted this week, but I'm telling you this, whether you've even thought about it or acknowledge it, you got the heartbeat you wanted this week. You got the breath you're breathing this week. You got to see your family this week, another week. You got to sleep in a bed this week. You were able to come into a church this week. You were able to pray again this week. You were able to read your Bible again this week. You were able to give to God again this week. And you know what you need to do is the same thing I need to do. We need to start spreading the good news of Jesus Christ and what God has done. People know that we're having it tough. We are cast aside on every hand. We are cast down. We are trodden and trampled underfoot. But let me tell you something. You need to do what Peter and those men did, and that is you just need to spread it and keep spreading it. Now, some of you may be confused. When you say spread it, Opie, what do you mean by spreading it? Well, Let's just talk about that for a second. You know, when you spread it, now I didn't plan on all this, but I'm going to need my water in a minute. This part. When you spread it, you got to understand something. People going to watch you. Y'all watching me right now? I'm looking at all of your eyes. Because some of you are thinking, I wonder if he's really going to spread it. I mean, this is church. I'm going to spread it. And when you spread it now, you might have to stir it up a little bit. Because see that oil? That oil's there, but it's sitting on top. We're told in Scripture we got to stir up the gift that's inside of us. That oil, I saw it. It was sitting right on top. So I got to stir it up a little bit because I want that peanut butter. I want it to spread correctly, you see. And so now that I know I woke up this morning feeling mighty fine with heaven on my mind, I woke up with joy in my soul and I thanked the Lord. I woke up and I came in here and about 9:15, me and about 50 fanatics got together and walked all over this church and started praying, and the Holy Ghost was here. And all I'm doing for the rest of y'all and everybody that wasn't here, I'm just spreading it and letting you know we had church. And there wasn't no music, there wasn't no reading, there wasn't no drama, there wasn't nothing but just praying to a mighty God. And I'm just spreading it and let everybody know on the World Wide Web and inside a multitude, he's a good God. And when you come together and you pray together, God will listen to you and he will respond. So I'm spreading it. I hope you were here because you already had church. See, when you spread it, it's kind of thick. And it's more than people can handle sometimes because they think they got to drink their way out of stuff, or they got to take pills or get involved in another, some kind of relationship that is just not holy. And so you got to take your time and you got to let people know, I'm righteous and I'm not budging, but I'm going to spread what God's done in my life. I'm going to spread how he took care of my children this week. I've just got to spread it because I'm hearing you talking and cussing and talking about everything that's negative and going wrong. I know it's all crooked. And I just heard a great message about 2 or 3 weeks ago. It's all going to be crooked because either everything from Hollywood, the entertainment industry, the sports industry, and politics and government, it's either ran by the Holy Spirit or it's ran by an evil spirit. And the same thing goes with the church and down to mine and your life. And if we are not operated and we're not ran by the Holy Spirit, then we're operated and we're ran and we're told what to do by an unholy or evil spirit. So you can always hear bad and negative things, what this president did, what that Congress did, what that company done, and what that bank did. You're going to hear all these things until you die, and people's always heard these things. We don't need to spread that anymore. Nobody ever got saved because they walked away from a negative conversation, but people will repent and they'll feel sorry about transgressing the law of God if you just spread the goodness of God, and you will find that even though you're sick in your body and you don't feel good, when you live a righteous way and you spread the righteous talk of God, you will come through what you're going through. That's the way it works, and you can't change it. So what you gonna do with half of that peanut butter sandwich? I'm gonna spread it. It is good. You hear me, don't you? And it's organic too, so there you go. That means it's only, I can't talk if y'all don't give me something to drink. My mouth thinks I'm laying sheetrock. Hold on. Something else I want to tell you about spreading it. It'll mess you up. It will mess you up. How many of you? It did. How many of you have ever prayed before and it was so good it messed you up? I got messed up this morning. Totally off guard, got messed up. And so you know what I'm going to do? When I leave church today, I'm going to a funeral that I got to help with. I'm going to a visitation at another place. And I'm going to let everybody know that starts asking me, especially if they're saying what's wrong, I'm going to start spreading how good church was today. It wasn't dry, peanut butter was, but church service wasn't. The worship wasn't dry. The giving wasn't dry. I don't even know what you gave, but it wasn't dry. The pre-service prayer this morning wasn't dry. I'm going out of this building today, and I'm spreading it. Because the righteous, they talk like God talks. Everybody knows I'm hurting. Everybody knows I'm overweight. Everybody knows my psychiatric gives me trouble down through here. But I ain't going to tell them about all that. I'm going to tell them about how healthy my spirit is right now. And before we pray, I just got a couple of scripture I want to leave with you. There's a lot of people that's already, Peter and the apostles, Daniel, he did righteous things the way God would do them. It got him in a den of lions, but because of his righteousness, he came through it. Amen? He wasn't the only one. Joseph, sold, betrayed by his family, locked in a dungeon, locked in a pit, lied to by fellow inmates. We can go on and on and on. But because he never wavered from living righteous, he came through it. Amen? God ordered his steps through every bit of it, even things he didn't want to walk through. But he stayed righteous. He wasn't the only one. Abraham, Paul, and Silas, and we could go on and on and on. But the kingdom of God, the Bible tells us, is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. If that's what the kingdom is, and we know the armor of God, the warfare material, the anointing, the power, the spirit, the miracles, all the things of God are inside of the kingdom of God, I'm going to live in a righteous way so that I can walk. I want to be a KK, and that ain't a Krispy Kreme. Angie would eat my arms and everything. I want to be a kingdom kid. That's what I want to do. I want to walk in the righteousness that only God gives. I'm going to ask you to close your eyes because there's a lot of people that have a lot going on. And God wants you to know if you will do the right thing all the time. If you got to go to the bank tomorrow, I got to get my taxes done this week, but I can tell you right now. Our CPA will tell you, if there is any area at all that it's questionable or gray, well, you might be all right with it. We don't even entertain that. Because I do everything I can in my life as unto the Lord, and that includes filling my taxes out. There's a lot of people are in deep bondage when it comes to financial matters, and they can't figure out why God doesn't move in that area. But God wants to do something in your life. He wants you to be in the kingdom, righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost, but we've got to live the way God wants us to live, and we've got to do the way God wants us to do. So God, today we need you to help us. We need you to show us, because we're not right, Lord, unless we are doing right. Doesn't matter how well we attended church last year, Lord, we're not right if we're not treating people right, acting right, giving right, praying right. Lord, there is no mistake in what a righteous person will do. So God, I pray you would help us today. Help us to realize that more people would come to church, more people would be saved, more people would be on fire for God if we would just spread your goodness, Lord. You said you will know them by their fruit. And Lord, maybe our fruit is what we spread and how often we spread. So God, move on us in everything you do. We're going to give you praise for it because you are good. And there is nobody good like you are, God. And we thank you so much. And all God's people said amen.
Thank you. so many dangers and toils of this life. I have already come, and He keeps on giving the grace and the strength to just keep pressing on. He's given a promise, and I'm gonna stand on every word that His holy word has said.
He made that in Yeah, it's about time to go. Not long. We got to go.
So, chairs, eh? What y'all doing with the chairs?
Well, it's getting a little crowded, so we tried to move some in the back. You know, people ordering too all the time. Like,
are you going to church tonight?
Oh, yeah, I'm going to church.
Yes, I'm
ready.
So excited.
Going to church. Yeah. You can sit on that crate.
Yeah.
I didn't know they were calling for bad weather.
Mm-mm. Well, I heard there was going to be a lot of flooding this spring, though. I did hear that.
Really?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I was wondering if my order came in.
What'd you order again? I'm sorry.
The paper and some new pencils and stuff.
Yeah, you can go back and get it if you want.
Oh,
okay. I forgot.
I'm going to church.
Good morning.
How
y'all doing this morning?
Hey, how you doing?
Morning. This evening. Sorry, my day's all mixed up.
Yeah, Sunday morning.
Going pretty good.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
What's going on with him?
He looks down.
Looks kind of down in the dumps.
How you doing? Hey. What's wrong?
What's the matter?
Well, y'all act like y'all all happy and everything.
What's there not to be happy about?
Right.
Spill it. Hey, brother, you awake, ain't you?
Yeah.
Well, I just prayed the Lord would let me know that he's all I need, and I really don't know if I should have prayed that at this moment, because, I mean, he just stripped everything from me, and I have no wife, I have no children are gone. And, I mean, I'm saved and all, but why would he do me like this? Why am I having to go through this?
Why do you have to go through this?
I mean, if you saved and all, I mean, I got Jesus in my heart, but it's supposed to be easier than this, don't it?
No.
He never promised that we wouldn't go through things.
That's right.
He promised, though, that he would give us the strength to make it through.
Yeah.
That's right.
And he would order our steps.
Amen.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
You got to wait on the Lord. He will resolve everything.
Never leave you nor forsake you.
Mm-hmm. I'm just telling y'all though, right now, I don't feel like he's with me.
You got to put on that shield of faith and trust that God is with you. And he will resolve every situation in due time.
It's just so hard, though. It's so hard. Y'all telling me this stuff, but it's so hard. But I thought being a Christian would be so much easier than this.
Sometimes go through.
We're all going through something. We're going through something.
That's true.
You know, I'm the pastor at the church, and there's over 220 people in this town. You know how many come to church on Sunday? 25.
It's about a handful.
That's tough.
Yeah, just a handful.
You know what, brother? And I hadn't told the town yet, but I've been offered a job over at Cedarville teaching. And the only thing I know to do is to pray, and I'm going to wait on the Lord.
That's right.
Because he'll give me my answer.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of times, this is how I think about it. If we weren't doing what we were supposed to be doing and loving the Lord to be a Christian and all, we wouldn't go through things.
That's right.
Because if it was easy, guess what? Everybody'd do it. And what did the preacher just say?
Mm-hmm.
Ain't many doing it in this town.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. We got to all stick together.
That's right.
That's right.
And Leroy, look, you know I'm going through all kind of medical stuff right now, and I'm trusting in the Lord. He didn't bring me this far to leave me.
That's right.
So I'm not turning back. I am.
Praise the Lord.
I love life every single day I get to breathe. Mm-hmm. I mean, I could have been gone a long time ago. Times look hard. They do. And you can't see the end of that tunnel, but it's going to be okay. You just got to push on.
I mean, I just feel like he could just take me right now.
Really?
That's what I feel like.
No.
You got to think about it. The God who saves you from your sins is right beside you.
That's right.
And you know what? One of the hardest things to face is people don't understand when we lose people that we were never promised another day on this earth, but we are promised days in glory.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Eternity.
I just think about it.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Amen.
God
is good.
Yep.
He's good.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
He's got plans.
Well, I appreciate y'all. I'm.
And he's there even when you don't feel him.
That's right. He never leaves us. Never, ever.
Mm-hmm.
You just continue seeking the Lord, and brother, he'll give you the answers.
I'm trying. I just didn't know it would be this hard, y'all.
Mm-hmm.
didn't mean to bother y'all and everything. That's
join us at church this morning.
Leroy, you got to make it. You're going to make it. God's going to bring you through this.
Yes, he is.
This too shall pass.
That's amen. Right. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And you're going to be able, whenever you go through this, when God brings you out on the other side, you're going to be able to share this experience with somebody else.
That's right, brother. Amen. This is part of your testimony, right?
Exactly.
That's
right.
Yes.
You'll look back for too long and think, Lord, thank you for bringing me through that.
That's right. Amen.
Well, I feel like I'm low as I can go. Maybe that's where I need to be so you can lift me back up, maybe.
Sometimes
that's
we right. have to be low, brother.
That's right.
Oh. Look up.
Yes.
Okay.
Hey.
Okay, we're going ready to go to church.
Yes,
yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. I have to go get my Bible.
The Lord said don't go to Cedarville. Stay here.
Is that what he told you?
Oh, my gosh. Praise God.
Let me get my Bible. Woo.
Yeah.
There's not a mountain too tall. There's not a problem so small that Jesus can't resolve. In time he'll get involved. It's our God, he cares about us. So
Hallelujah. 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 Worship the Lord. Worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Worship the Lord God Almighty. Worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many people in this place right now, you've come through something. You've come through it. I, as a testimony, I want you to meet me at the altar. I've come through it. Doesn't mean you're not in something else or you won't go, but you've come through something. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Everything that's moving right now is a testimony. You wait on the Lord. You live righteous. Hallelujah. You can come through it. Glory, glory, glory. I've come through it. I've come through it. I just want the church to meet us at the altar so we can thank God together. Lord God. Oh God, oh God. God, I've come through it, Lord. I'll come through this. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to His name, glory to His name. Hallelujah. Wait on the Lord, be of good strength. Wait, I say, wait, I say, wait, I say, wait on the Lord, wait on the Lord. Hallelujah. I would just pray and thank God for bringing me through it. Testimony is that if He brought you through it before, He'll bring you through it another time and another time. I'm just going to do the right thing. I'm just going to live the right way. If you're not a believer, this is all you have to do. Jesus, I'm a sinner. I cannot and will not go to heaven if You don't save me. I repent. I need to be saved, Lord. I must be saved. There is no other way but through Jesus, oh God. And I come to You in the name of Jesus and ask You to forgive me of my sin. Hallelujah. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth, you believe it in your heart, you'll be saved. Hallelujah. God, I love You this morning. I thank You for Your presence, oh Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. I'm going to spread it, God. I'm going to spread it. You're a faithful God. I'm going to spread it. You're a loving God. I'm going to spread it. You're a God that's worthy to be praised. I'm going to spread it. You're a God that brings us through it. I'm going to spread it. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to His name. Hallelujah, I thank You, Lord, You know my name. I thank You, Lord, You never take Your eye off of me. I thank You, oh God. Hallelujah, we worship You, God. Nobody or nothing else matters but You, Lord. My eyes are on You, God, and Your goodness. You've blessed me. You've done great and mighty things for me. I'm still alive, Lord. In spite of it, I came through it, but I'm still alive, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, I give You praise this morning. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy. You are doing a work. And God, we're just blessing You right now because You are worthy to be praised, Lord. God, we thank You that You've been with us since we walked in this building today. God, we thank You that You've already walked through this room. You've been with us the whole time. God, You've been touching us. You've been saying things to us that nobody even knows but we ourselves, Lord. You've been dealing with us about circumstances and situations. And God, we don't have the answers we need, but God, we've got the peace that You give. You're going to bring us through everything, God, because we belong to You. We belong to You, oh Lord. God, and I'm praying that my mind will stay